So this is our problem as well. We think to ourselves, we appease ourselves. Alhamdulillah, I am performing my salah. What is that? Jumah salah. Do you know, when we get this marriage proposal, so we ask this question, is he practicing? Yes, of course, Mufti Saab is practicing. So does he read 5 times salah? 5 times then and now, but he does read Jumah, Mufti Saab. Yes, he reads Jumah. So Jumah we read, mashallah. I was in Portugal a few weeks ago. In one of the masjid, Baytul Mukarram, they have Jumu'ah in one masjid, 6 Jumu'ah. So many people. But in Fajr Salah, there'll be 1 line or 2 lines maximum. So where's all the Musalli gone? So this is the mentality we have created in ourselves, because we have thought to ourselves that we just need to do some aspects of deen, and the rest of the deen we don't need to follow. Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu dkhulu fis silmi kaffa. Oh, the people, enter Islam entirely. وَلَا تَتَّبِيُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ. Don't follow the footsteps of the shaitan. إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ. Indeed, he is your clear enemy. We need to make sure that we follow the religion 100%. Like this person, he was doing the tattoo of a lion on his back. Obviously, doing tattoo is haram. So he was doing that, and when the needle was being pierced into his body, he was screaming. So he said to the person who was doing the tattoo, he goes, what are you doing? He said, I'm doing the head. Because forget the head, do the tail or somewhere else, some other part of the body. So he started doing the legs, so he started screaming again. What are you doing? So he couldn't take the pain. So he said, I'm doing the legs, do some other part, do the stomach or something. So he started doing the stomach, then he started screaming again. He couldn't take the pain. Because what are you doing now? Because the stomach, because forget that, do something else. So the person who was doing the tattoo, he stopped. Because I'm not going to do anything. Look, you know the type of lion you want, even Allah hasn't created that kind of lion. So the point here is, the way we are acting upon Islam, pick and choose. We take these things on board, some of the things, no, we won't take this. This is easy for us. Jumu'ah is easy. Fajr namaz is too hard. We'll put that to aside. Okay, marriage, okay. We'll call the Imam Sahib, the Sheikh. He'll perform the nikah. After that, we'll do whatever we want. We'll have our music. We'll have our belly dancers. We'll have this. We'll have that. So all the things, what we're doing is, we try to do things according to our Islam. Not according to Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When this Quranic verse, Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu dkhulu fis silmi kaffa, was revealed. Why was it revealed? What's the backdrop? What's the shan and nuzul to this? Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Salam radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he was a Jewish rabbi. So he reverted to Islam, and some of his colleagues, companions, and when, after reverting to Islam, so they thought to themselves, because they were mashallah well versed in their religion as well, they thought, we will combine the both religion. So what we'll do in our tahajjud salah, we'll also recite the Torah as well as the Quran. And because consuming camel meat is not something which is necessary in Islam, if you don't eat camel meat, it doesn't mean you're out of the fold of Islam. So because in Judaism, camel meat was prohibited. So basically what they did was, they said, okay, we won't consume camel meat, so we'll be also following the Judaism, Jewish faith as well. So when this was put forward, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately revealed the verse. Udkhulu fis silmi kaffa. Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu, udkhulu fis silmi kaffa. Enter Islam entirely. Wala tattabi'u. Don't let the shaitan misguide you, because this is what shaitan wants. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came out with the message that Islam, qulu la ilaha illa tuflihun, say la ilaha illa, start, and you come into the fold of Islam. So these people, they said, what are you talking about? أَجَعَلَ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَهُ وَاحِدًا إِنَّ هَذَا لَشَيْءٌ عُجَابٌ. Are you making all gods into one god? But they had 360 idols. هَذَا رَبُّ الرِّزْقِ هَذَا رَبُّ الْمَتَرِ. They had all the different gods for different things. So basically they said, all our gods put together, they can't fulfill our needs. And he's got one god, he's going to fulfill everyone's needs. إِنَّ هَذَا لَشَيْءٌ عُجَابٌ. This is very astonishing. So what they came up with in the tafsir of Quliyayul Kafir, Suratul Kafirun, it comes that what happened, these people came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, let us come to a compromise. How do you come to a compromise? What we'll do is, we'll worship your God, one God, for 1 year continuously, and then the next year you worship our gods, multiple. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam immediately rejected. And he said, no. So, okay, if you don't want to accept this, okay, just don't say anything bad about our gods. Just go and embrace one of our gods, and we'll say that you revere them and you respect them. So he said, no, I'm not going to even do that. So immediately Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam with Suratul Kafirun. Qul ya ayyuhal kafirun, la a'budu ma ta'budun. Say to the displeased. Allah is very angry here, saying, la a'budu ma ta'budun. Don't worship. I don't worship what you worship. Say it to them very clear. La a'budu. And this is very important for our youngsters, because in schools and college and university outside, they'll be teaching with this comparative religion. Every religion is okay. I have so many teachers who come and they tell me that we have to teach comparative religion in primary school, secondary school. We can't even say which religion is right. We can't even say Islam is right, because that will be against the teaching laws. We'll be violating the rules. So we have to get that in our mind, my brothers and sisters, my youngsters who are listening, that inna deena indallahi al-islam. Indeed, deen in the eyes of Allah, the way of life, the religion, the creed, the faith, is only Islam. Further on in that surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْ. The person who searches for any other religion other than Islam, فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْ. It will never be accepted from him. وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. In the hereafter, it will be from the losers. So we have to get that in our minds. Many of these people come, the Christians, the Jews, and they say to me, Mr. Mufti, you are a greedy person. I said, what do you mean? You only say Muslims are going to go into paradise. What about us? I said, you believe the same. لَا يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا وَنَصَارًا. The Jews say only Jews are going to go. The Christians and the Christians are going to go. So why not? Are you not greedy as well? Because I'm following my religion. I'm 100% convinced that my religion will take me to success, and it will give me salvation in this world and the hereafter. What's the problem with that? Everybody's got the right to follow whichever religion they want to follow. So the point here is we need to get that in the minds of our children, in the hearts, and they should not be indoctrinated and brainwashed by that. Oh, it's so easy. Like some youngsters will say, you know, that Christianity is good, that religion is good. But you just have to go to church once a week and that's it. We have to go 5 times a day. Look at the way they're getting brainwashed. So we have to get that in our mind, that we have to make sure that Islam is completely implemented into the minds and the hearts of every youngster. So the point here is, we have to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this beautiful way of life. Deen translated the way of life. That everything, not only a religion, is a way of life. From morning till dusk, from birth till death, everything is governed by Islam, by Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In our religion, we have the different aspects of our ibadat. Like obviously, as I said, that Islam is a complete religion. We can't just pick and choose. أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. Are you believing some part of the book and you leaving and rejecting the other? We have to make sure we are full Muslim, complete Muslim. الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ. Allah has completed the religion. So Hakim ulama Shaykh Hashim Ali Thani rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions there's 5 branches of faith. We have the aqaid, the beliefs. Then we have the ibadat, the fasting, zakat, hajj, the salah, all these pillars of Islam. Then we have the mu'amalat, the transaction. Then we have the mu'ashrat, social interaction. Then we have the akhlaq, we have the character. So all these are part of our way of life, of our faith. It's very important. We can't just subtract something, we can't just put aside something. No, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. The biggest problem we have is, as I said, we're taking some part, like that person who's doing the tattoo. We're taking some part. No, this is wrong, this is no, okay, I'm going to be a Muslim, but I'm not going to keep my beard. I'm going to Muslim sister, but I'm not going to wear the hijab. Okay, when I get the time, I'll read my salah. When I don't get the time, I'm not going to read my salah. We can't be a Muslim like that. We have to make sure that we follow the religion fully. And the chaos that we are having in this world, if we are being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will be all completely, this depression, this anxiety, the stress, everything will go away if we follow the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala properly. If we get that remembrance of Allah, the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our lives, Allah bi dhikrillahi tatma'innul qulub. Remember, by the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the hearts are content. You know, this great scholar in America, so he was just getting ready for his Friday sermon. So whilst he was getting ready, he was preparing his lecture. So his son started to disturb him. Young child started to disturb. So to keep him busy, engaged with something, and in the meanwhile he could actually prepare for his Jummah sermon, he got a jigsaw of the world map. And he took out all the pieces and he gave it to his son. He said, my son, come here. You do this jigsaw of the world, and whilst you look at all this and you try to find out which country joins which country, whilst you'll be busy doing that, I will be able to get ready for my Jummah sermon. So the father thought, mashallah, it'll take ages to do that, and in that meanwhile he will not bother me, I will be able to focus on my Jummah speech and sermon, and I could be ready and I could go, and my child will be busy trying to do the jigsaw. But within few seconds, within few minutes, the son comes back, Abu, I finished the jigsaw. So the father thought, mashallah, my son is clever, but not that clever. How did he manage to put all these different continents and different countries? Where's Africa? Where's America? Where's Asia? Where's Europe? And where's this country? Where's that country? So how did he manage? And he looked at it and he said, Subhanallah. It's amazing. You put everything in its right places. So the son goes, Abu, look at the other side. Look at the flip side, the reverse side. He looked at it, he goes, you know, there's a person, there's an image of a person. So if you put his arms and legs and feet and body parts together, the world map gets together. So the child, he actually did the person, body figure on the other side, and the world map became right as well. So the father says, oh my son, beta, you've given me a topic. When man is right, the world is right. When the man is right, the world is right. So basically, I need to make sure that I am correct. Nowadays, you know, we have this tendency, we have always this kind of mentality, looking at faults at other people. We never look at problems ourselves. Sayyiduna Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, subhanallah, when he was going to his entourage with all his the human beings, the jinnat, the birds, the animals, when he used to be, basically, virtually he used to be flying in the air. So once he was traveling and he looked around for his hudhud bird, he couldn't find it. So what did he say? Ma li la aral hudhud. What is wrong with me? I can't find hudhud. Under this tafsir, Mufassirun, the commentators, they mention that why, you know, why did he say Mali? What is wrong with me? So the scholars say that Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, first of all, initially he blamed himself. There must be something wrong in myself, shortcoming in myself, that I cannot find hudhud. So that's why the scholars, the pious people, إِذَا تَفَقَّدُوا أَعْمَالَهُمْ. If you actually don't find that you are missing out in these, oh, today I could not perform my tahajjud salah, I couldn't recite my Quran, I missed out in my ma'amulas. Why? So they used to look at, I must be doing something wrong. They never used to blame somebody else. Nowadays we blame everybody else. You know, all the problems in this world, you know, we always blame, oh, it's because of Trump, oh, it's because of Boris Johnson, it's because of Modi, it's because of, we tend to blame everybody else, but nobody blames themselves. So we have to start with ourselves, sort ourselves out. Like this person, he said, I will sort the problem of the world. Don't worry. I will sort the problem. I will resolve all the problems in the world. So he started to sit down and do all this kind of different planning and write theoretically, basically everything he was writing down. So this will happen. And if this happens, I'll change the government. I'll change this. And he, mashallah, he's running the world from his bedroom. So basically, after some years, he realized that this is not going to work. There's nothing practical there. So basically, after some time, forget the world, I'll sort out my country. I'll sort out my country. So after some time, he thought, okay, I'll change the government, I'll do this, I'll change the MPs, I'll do this and I'll do that. So after some time, he realized that's not going to happen as well. So then he thought, okay, I'll do my own town. And then he realized it's 30 years have passed by, what am I going to do? Okay, forget all this, I'm going to do my family. The family, you know, he started to talk to his sons and daughters, they've all grown up. He goes, Abu, why are you telling us about salaah? Why are you telling about these things now? You know, son, we don't read them anyhow. So why don't you read yourself? And he realized, Allahu Akbar, that's right. If 40 years ago, when I started this plan, if I started myself, you know, son, practicing the deen, what would have happened? That would have an effect on my children. That's what the Quran says, Qu anfusakum wa ahlikum nara. Save yourself, save your family members from the fire of Jahannam. We need to start from ourselves. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with a message, what did he do? Wa anzira ashiratakal aqrabin. That warn your close relatives. Ya Fatima, ankidhi nafsaki minan nar, fa inni la ughni anki min Allah shay. Oh Fatima, save yourself from the fire of Jahannam, because I will not be able to help you on the day of judgment. You need to have iman. Even Abu Talib, when he was leaving the world, said qul kalimatun uhajju bi, just say the kalima, I'll do the rest. I can't do anything without you saying the kalima. So the point here is, we need to start off with ourselves. Every single one of us listening, we need to start off with ourselves. Where are we going wrong? We will be telling our children, read salah. Look, the problem here is, many a times parents say, beta, do what I tell you to do. Don't do what I do. I'm smoking, don't you smoke. I went to one house, I was salah time. I said, okay, we're all going to do jamaat here. So I said to the father, okay, you know, put the musallas, the prayer mats. So the sons, they all came and read. And I said to the father, come and join me. He goes, no, I need to do wuzu. I said, we'll wait for you. No, I'll do wuzu later. I said, no, you have to join. He goes, no, Mufti Saiful, you know, my clothes are dirty. I said, I will wait. You can change, it's in your house. But the son comes, the young boy, he comes, Mufti Saiful, my father never reads namaz. I go, okay. What is that going to do? Look at the children, they're already making comments about you, that you don't read namaz. So that's not going to help. So we need to be role models ourselves. We have to walk the talk. We can't just be saying like, I want my children to be hafiz and alim. Every Mufti Saiful do dua, my son becomes hafiz, alim, he becomes a khadim deen, and this and that, subhanallah. And what are you doing? You're not even reading your salah, you're not even practicing deen yourself. We have to be practicing ourselves first. So the main point is, illal musalleen. That if we become musalli, if we become punctual in the salah, then you see the results. Because this salah is very, very important. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was mentioning the qualities of those people who are going to be successful. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Indeed, the believers successful. الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Those people who in salah, they are humble. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after mentioning all the other qualities, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنِ اللَّغْوِ مُعْرِضُونَ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِلزَّكَاةِ فَاعِلُونَ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِفُرُوجِ مُحَافِظُونَ إِلَّا عَلَىٰ أَزْوَاجِهِمْ أَوْ مَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ غَيْرُ مَلُومِينَ فَمَنِ ابْتَغَى وَرَاءَ ذَٰلِكَ فَلَا مُنْعَادٌ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِأَمَانَاتِهِمْ وَأَحْدِهِمْ رَاعُونَ الَّذِينَ عَلَىٰ صَلَوَاتِهِمْ يُحَافِظُونَ. Allah ends up with saying salah as well. Starts with salah, ends up with salah. So now we can understand how important and how significant salah is. That starts off with salah, that you have to have humility, and finishes off yuhafidhun. And those who understand Arabic, yuhafidhun is from the bab mufa'ala. Both ways. If you safeguard namaz, namaz will safeguard you. Muhafaza. So if you safeguard namaz, namaz will safeguard you. From where? From the fire of Jahannam. Or else, if we didn't safeguard namaz, what's going to happen? Allahu Akbar, Allah save us. Ma salakakum fi saqar. On the day of judgment, when people will be entered into Jannat, and those people who are destined for Jahannam, they will enter Jahannam. So some of the people of Jannat, they'll say, where are our friends gone? Where are our associates, our relatives, our people, that our neighbors, those people who we always socialized with? So Allah will say, if they're not in Jannat, they will be in Jahannam. There's no third place. Even from A'raf, they will be ending up in Jannat. So from A'raf, they will be udkhulul jannata la khawfun alaykum wa la antum tahzanun. They will end up in Jannah. So there will be only two groups, Jannat or Jahannam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that these people will peep into Jahannam and they will see their friends. Allahu Akbar, what are you doing? Ma salakakum fi saqar. What has taken you to the fire of Jahannam? And the Quran is saying in Surah Al-Muddathir, qalu lam nakum minal musallin. That we are not from those people who read salah. We didn't perform salah, and because of this reason, my brothers and sisters, we might be thinking, oh, alhamdulillah, we have read the kalima. You know, Wahab bin Munabbir rahmatullahi alayhi, he used to always give lecture. Make sure you read your salah, make sure you don't do this, make sure you don't commit these sins. So the people said, Wahab, what are you talking about? Because the hadith says, man kana akhiru kalami la ilaha illallah dakhala al-jannah. The person who has read the kalima, the person who has become a Muslim and his last words are the la ilaha illallah, he'll enter Jannah. So this salah and all this haven't been mentioned. So it doesn't matter if somebody doesn't read his salah, he'll still go into Jannah. So he gave a beautiful answer. He goes, I know that the la ilaha illallah is miftahul Jannah. In the hadith he comes, la ilaha illallah is the key to Jannah. But the keys needs to have the, what do you call them? The keys, it needs to have the quds. The teeth, that's the word. Teeth. He needs to have the teeth. If he doesn't have the teeth, he can't open the door. So you won't be able to open Jannah without a key having the teeth. So this is the point that we have to keep in mind. We got the key, but it's a broken key. Salah is the proper and correct rectified key. So we need to make sure that we have the full key. And so Wahab bin Munabbih rahmatullahi alayhi is saying, subhanallah, that you have got your iman. That's very good. Alhamdulillah, we have got iman. And in this world, only about 20% have iman, who are believers. So in that sense, subhanallah, this 20%, so from the 100%, the out of all the 7 billion people, about just under 2 billion people, they are the Muslims. But from there, how many percent are practicing Muslim? How many people are performing the 5-time prayers? We need to ask ourselves. That's a very small percentage. So we need to make sure that we are punctual in our salah. So else what is going to happen is, these people, they will have to burn in the fire of Jahannam for each salah. And that's a very serious case. Because أَوَّلُ مَا يُحَاسَبُ بِهِ الْعَبْدُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ الصَّلَاةِ. The first thing to be reckoned on the day of judgment is salah. So now my brothers and sisters, listen. Now if a child obviously becomes baligh, Islamically, a boy or a girl becomes baligh from the age of 15 years old. And that's according to the lunar calendar. Lunar calendar is 354 days. And the solar calendar is 365 days. So according to the solar calendar, it will be 14 years and about 7 months. So according to the solar calendar, if a child, a boy or a girl, reaches that age from that time, he is classified he is regarded as an adult, man and a woman. It's no more boy and a girl. Not like our rule, our laws here, that from 16 years, he's an adult, and under 16, he's a young child. So if he's before his 16th birthday, any 11, 15, and he committed any crime or something, no, he's a junior. And from that time onwards, he becomes a senior from 12 o'clock. So this is not in Islam. Islam, a person 14 years and 7 months, that's where he becomes baligh. And Islamically, if it's the solar calendar, lunar calendar is 15. Then before that, so that's by age. So if a child from the age of 12 till that 14 and 7 months, if he has a wet dream, or he has any signs of bulugh, and especially the wet dream, if he has a wet dream from that time onwards, for example, he had it at night time, from that day, from Fajr time, he is classed as a baligh, is classed as an adult, boy or a girl. So please take that as a note, because a lot of people think, no, it's only 15. No, if a child before that, he has a wet dream, so basically from that time onwards, what will happen is he'll be classified as an adult. And so if he had a wet dream at night time, from that Fajr, Allah is going to ask him. Every Fajr. So from that time onwards, he lives till 65, for example. And so about 50 years of his namaz, 50 times 365 times 5. Allah is going to ask. And he'll say, Acha, you became baligh at night time. Can I have an account for Fajr? Well, I didn't know about Fajr. I didn't read it. Punishment will start. And then Zuhur, Asr, Maghrib, Isha. What are we going to answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah's already told us the question. You know, if the teacher, the examiner tells us the questions which are going to come in exams, we'll be over the top. We'll be happy, mashallah. I know the questions, I'm going to get ready. We know the questions. The three questions in the grave. Ma rabbuka, ma deenuka, man hadha rajul ladhi bu'itha ilayhi. And who is your Lord? What is your religion? Who is the person who has been sent towards you? We know the questions. We need to prepare for them. And don't think that these answers are going to come just like this. We have to be accustomed to it. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. You understand? But when a cat and he pounced on him, he started to scream. So at that time, you know, the owner thought he's going to say Subhanallah something, alhamdulillah. But because he was being taught, it's been parrot fashion. So nowadays we, Rabbi Allah, Rabbi Allah, Deen al-Islam, Deen al-Islam. This is parrot fashion. We have to live a life according to that. So that's why he says, كَمَا تَعِيشُونَ تَمُوتُونَ وَكَمَا تَمُوتُونَ تُحْشَرُونَ. Like the way you lived, you will die. And like the way you died, that's the way you will be resurrected. So it's not going to just happen, miracle happens, that, oh, we answer all the questions. Yes, yes, namaz, yeah, Allah says, okay, you're forgiven, go to Jannah. It's not easy as it we think. So this is the point that we have to keep that in mind. So a boy or a girl, 14 years, 7 months, solar calendar, that's, he gets baligh, if there's no signs of bulugh before that. So for a girl, if she has her menstrual cycles before that, from the age of 9 till that 14 years of 7 months, any signs there, she will be classed as a baligha, and she will be classed as an adult woman, and she will be questioned about every salah. And for a boy, from the age of 12, if he has any wet dream after that, from that time onwards, after having a faraz ghusl, he has to make sure that he performs his salah. That has to be clear. And don't start watching these YouTube or start watching these Islamic programs on the TV where those people say, okay, you go Makkah, Medina and do Tawbah, all your sins are forgiven, even your namaz that you missed, all forgiven. Many people come, Mufti Saab, you know, yassiru wala tuassiru. Make it easy, don't make it hard. The hadith is saying, yuridullah bikumul yus, Allah intends good, easy for you. And you always make it hard. You always saying, I have to read all my 50 years by namaz. I've gone to Umrah, I got hold of the gilaf of the Kaaba, and I pray to Allah, Allah forgive all my salah. I missed 50 years of salah, from today I'll read everyone. And all that fast I missed, Allah forgive me. All the zakat I haven't given. And the Imam Sahib on the Islam channel or whatever, they told us that it's all okay, you do Tawbah. Atta ibn azam bikam Allah zama. So they got evidence as well. So I'm going to just follow them, it's easier. And Quran says, you know, Allah intends easiness. I said, you know, don't try to deceive yourself. يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَمَا يَخْدَعُونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَيَشْرُونَ. You're just deceiving yourself. So don't, Allah ko bas ye, any dhoka dene ki koshish na kare. You know, like people think to themselves, no, it's not so easy. It's not going to be fair. I'm going to say, look, I've been reading my namaz from the age of 10. And this person, 65, he goes and does one tawbah and that's it, is all forgiven. You know, what are we going to do? All those people who've been reading namaz all their life, fasting all our lives. So justice, وَمَا رَبُّكَ بِظَلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ. Your Lord, He doesn't do zulm on anybody. Inna Allah la yadhlimu mithqala dharra wa in taku hasanatan yudha'ifha wa yu'ti min ladunhu ajran 'azima. Faman ya'mal mithqala dharratin khayran yara wa man ya'mal mithqala dharratin sharran yara. Everything will be in front. So obviously that's a separate issue that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives. But if a person thinks to himself, no, I'll just keep on committing sins. You know, a person thinks to himself, you know, if I break my hands or something, I got the hospital, I got, you know, they'll put the wound, bandage and everything, so I'll just break my hands. That will be, call that person a fool. So in the same way, if just on that assumption that Allah might forgive, Allah might forgive, but this is this person, what does the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ say? Al-kayyisu man dana nafsahu wa amila lima ba'd al-maut. Intelligent person is a person, man dana nafsahu, who suppresses, who and he subdues his nafs, wa amila lima ba'd al-maut, and he gets ready for the akhirah. Well, ajiz, that is a foolish person who ajizu man atba'a nafsahu, he follows his desires, wa tamanna 'ala Allah, and he says Allah par bharosa karte hai. We just depend on Allah, Allah will forgive, Allah is forgiving. You ask the person, brother, why don't you read namaz? Allah will forgive. When I get ready, I will do it. So this is the wrong mentality we have. So my brothers and sisters, what we need to do in terms of our salah, we need to, like today gathering, we need to make sure that we start performing our salah. We need to make sure the man we need to read in jamaat. Salatul jamaati afdhal min salatil fardh bi 27 wa 20 daraja. Read salah in jamaat, it's 27 times more superior. So get the habit of reading salah in jamaat. All the men, women folk, read the namaz on time. Inna salata kanat al-mu'minin kitaban mawquta. Salah is fixed. It's not that end of the day I'll read all my 5-time prayers because I'm busy with my college, university, work, and I'll come. Many of our brothers and sisters do that. So no, that's not going to be right. So we need to make sure that we read our salah on time. We need to make sure that we're reading our 5-time prayers. In terms of the prayers that we have missed, we need to make sure that we make a timetable and we look at the time. For example, I missed the last 10 years of my namaz, so I need to make a timetable. I'll read all my fajr on a daily, make sure I finish my all fajr, then zuhar, then asr. Or you can do it on a daily basis. With each day's salah, you read one day salah that has been missed. For example, you missed 10 years of salah, so okay, I'll read one day salah. And if a person wants, like mashallah, many brothers and sisters, they said, okay, Mufti Saab, oh subhanallah, what is going to happen to me? I'll make sure that I read 10 days namaz in one day. And it can happen. It takes about 20 minutes, because 20 rakats with the witr, 3 is 20 rakats on a daily basis. 20 rakats will take you 20 minutes. So in 1 hour, you can read 3 days namaz. You understand? In 2 hours, 6 days. In 3 hours, nine days namaz. So you can easily finish. Instead of wasting our time on our social media, we need to really take that serious. Because Allah is not going to ask us anything else. I said to the brothers and sisters, you can stop eating, you can stop drinking, you can stop sleeping. All this will be okay. But your salah, if you close your eyes now, Allah is not going to ask you about your GCSE, about your A-levels, about your degree. If you have missed your salah, this is more important than anything else put together. So we need to really take it serious. So my brothers, salah, because we come into these gatherings, the objective, the spirituality will not be attained if our salah is not in our life. In the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the difference between a believer and a disbeliever was salah. If a person read his salah, is a believer. If a person, he didn't read his salah, he was classed as a disbeliever. That's why even the munafiqun, they used to stand, وَإِذَا قَامُوا لَسْلَاتِ قَامُوا كُسَلَىٰ. Even the munafiqun, they used to come for salah because of the fear that people will class us as disbelievers. And today, Allahu Akbar, we call ourselves, no, I'm a practicing person. But where's our salah? بَشِّرِ الْمَشْرَائِنَ بِالنُّورِ التَّامِ فِي الظُّلَمِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Fajr salah, Maghrib salah, Isha salah. When it's dark, coming there, the Prophet ﷺ has said, give glad tidings to those people of a complete light on the time when it will be completely darkness, on the day of judgment, when the person will be crossing the sirat, the bridge. At that time, Allah will create the light for that person. So every one of us, we need to get this in our mind, that this salah is the most important. We hear about salah so many times. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions salah so many times in the Quran. Why is he repeating? فَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ ذِكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Remind the believers, because reminding the believers will benefit the believers. So each one of us, we need to take heed that today, whilst we are sitting down here, inshallah ta'ala, we'll be doing short dhikr and this dua as well, and finishing it off. But the main important thing, my brothers and sisters, why have we come here? Is it just going to happen that we're going to listen to something and then we're going to go back home and forget about it? The father was addressing the son. The son was playing with his mobile phone. The father said to the son, did you hear what I said? So the son looked up, he goes, I forgot. Because it seems that he went through one ear and he came out of the other ear. So the son says, pretty much, because that's good. That's good. A time will come that the message will not go into the first ear in the first place. Person will not even bother to listen. So So many of us, we come here, we just come, acha, we're going to have good food here, mashallah. We're just going to meet our friends here. Our intention is not even correct as well. So we need to make sure that we come here with the intention that we're going to take some. Is that a promise, everyone? We can make this promise, and we need to make sure that we stay steadfast. We do tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive our sins and make the timetable. And as I said, like the time of fitna, satakunu fitna, samma, bakma, amya. Fitna will come and make a person deaf, dumb and blind. You will see many, because that's why he says in the hadith that inna Allah la yaqbidul ilma intizan yantazi'u min al-ibad. Allah will not take the knowledge by just snatching the knowledge away from the hearts of the ulama. Walakin yaqbidul ilma biqabdil ulama. But Allah will take this knowledge away by taking the ulama. Like we've seen so many ulama leaving this world. Hatta idha lam yubqi aliman. You know, he reminds me of subhanallah, the great scholar Sheikh Nurul Islam Sahib from Bishnath in Bangladesh. Subhanallah, when he was leaving this world, that's the kind of death we should be hoping for and aspiring to from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and wishing and desiring and doing dua. So what happened was, I asked his son, what was his last moments? Like our Hazrat Mawlana Yusuf Mutala Sahib wrote a kitab, amazing, Buzrugon ke Wisal ke Ahwal, the last moments of the pious. It's an amazing kitab. We should read that. It's in Urdu, it's in English as well. We should read that, and subhanAllah, the concern. That's why there should be no pride in ourselves, because we don't know. Innamal a'malu bil khawatim. Indeed, the actions are according to the last deeds. We don't know what's going to happen in our end time. So we need to always be humble. We shouldn't have pride and arrogance in ourselves, because what's going to happen at the last moments, nobody knows. So he says about this person, subhanAllah, he called his family members and he said, look, please forgive me. I forgive all of you, and do dua for me. And then he says that I never ever fear death. I want to embrace death, because tuhfatul mu'mini al-maut, that the tuhfa, a gift for a believer, is death. Because man ahabba liqa Allah, the person who loves to meet Allah, Allah loves to meet that person. And this only way I could meet my Allah is by leaving this world. So I want to meet my Allah, I want to meet my Creator, subhanallah. He says, don't worry, you know, I'm waiting for this. All my life, I've been craving to meet my Allah, so let me go peacefully. He's saying that to his children at that last moments. Allahu Akbar. Then he reads the kalima shahada loudly, ashadu Allah ilaha illa ashadu Muhammad Rasulullah. He reads that loudly, he makes everyone witness, and then immediately within a few seconds, he leaves this world. Look at the kind of death. Shaykhul Hadith, Muhaddis Sahib, Tahfizul Haq Sahib Rahmatullah Alayhi. You know, like I said, kama ta'ishuna tamutuna wa kama tamutuna tuhsharun. All his life he was teaching hadith for 50 years. Continuously he was teaching Bukhari Sharif. So on the day he died, he was still teaching Bukhari Sharif. He taught Bukhari Sharif in the girls' madrasa, then the boys' madrasa. Whilst he was reading Bukhari Sharif, he had a heart attack, and then he was taken on the way. He did not even reach the hospital. He died on the way. Subhanallah. This is the thing, because these people, they lived a life. They had a purpose in life. Our purpose in life, subhanallah, ma hiya illa hayatuna dunya namutu wa nahya wa ma yuhlikuna illa. We live, we die, nothing finishes at good time. Because our mentality, no, work, sleep, work, that's what it is. We're like robots. We're just moving around everywhere, not thinking to ourselves the importance of life. That what's the purpose? Afahasibtum annama khalaqnakum abatha. Do you think Allah has created you futile? Wa annakum ilayna la turja'un. And Allah is not going to return, you're not going to be returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ayahsabu insanu ayyutraka suda. Mankind thinks he's been creating futile. There's a purpose behind our life. We can't just be wasting our life. Unfortunately, we think that Allah's talking about agnostic and the atheists and the evolutionists and those people who don't believe in the existence of God. Allah's talking even to us as well. Even though we don't believe in that, but our practical life is showing that. When the muazzin is saying, as-salatu khayru minan nawm, salah is better than sleep, we are still sleeping. So what is that telling us? Because we are saying practically, an-nawmu khayru min as-salah, sleep is better than namaz. Because why are we not getting up? So when this woman, this sister asked the sheikh that how can I get my children for salah? Because they are fast asleep and it's very hard to wake them up. So he gave a beautiful example. He said, what if the house caught fire? Are you going to wake your children? Because of course, because no, you're not going to wake them up. Because of course I'm going to. Because no, they're fast asleep. Because no, I'm going to get them up. No, they're not going to be waking up. You wake them up, they'll be so sleepy, they won't wake up. Because no, I'm going to drag them out. I said, Allahu Akbar, you're going to drag them out. Why? To save them from the worldly fire. What about the fire of Jahannam, which is 70 times more hot? My brothers, if we can get that in our mind, Allahu Akbar, we will jump off of the bed. Jump. And we'll go straight to the masjid. We'll have this in our mind. How can I miss my salah? What's going to happen to me? That namaz I'm going to miss, subhanallah. I'll have to burn in the fire of Jahannam for that amount of time, subhanallah. So basically, how am I going to answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? First thing on the day of Jum, Allah is going to ask her about salah. So we need to really take it serious. We can't just sit back and go back home today and think to ourselves, no, it's okay, it's just another lecture and we'll go to sleep and nothing's going to happen. Allahu Akbar, don't take it lightly. Please take it seriously. Brothers and sisters who are listening and those who are listening on live as well, please take it serious. We all need to make changes in our life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a tawfiq. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll do a short zikr and then dua will take place. JazakAllah Khair. Ahsan al-jaza for listening attentively.
قل إن الهدى هدى الله